Okay, good evening. First of all, I would like to thank Mafalda, Francesco, Simone, Andrea, and of course Alessandro Montel for the invitation. We are here with great pleasure in this summer heat. I also would like to express my gratitude because the people who invited us are our friends, in some cases former colleagues, so part of the work that I'm going to present is actually let's say a representation of a collective dimension of our office, which includes Francesco, sitting in the first row and curator of this program. I have decided to build a presentation that gives some sort of background to the topic that you are investigating through this workshop, and it's called Authenticity and Contradiction. Because through our practice, we have focused our, let's say, intention and we have focused our attention to preservation and authenticity, but specifically to the contradictory and controversial aspects of such notions and practice. Maybe some of you know that since few months we are involved in Palermo. And I will start with Palermo because it's also another city like Syracuse that is actually witnessing and experiencing the contradiction of authenticity, the UNESCO system, and the preservation. The drawing that you see here, it's a panorama of Palermo, drawn by Schinkel, by a very young Schinkel in 1808, when he was actually visiting Sicily as part of his grand tour. What is very beautiful about this perspective drawings is that city and territory are represented as a unicum, physical and cultural. And the same kind of attitude is to be found also in cartography or landscape paintings, where the city was always basically considered as an integral part of a much extended landscape. It was true for these people who actually visited Sicily at starting from the mid-18th and 19th century. And we made an experiment, you know, people like Goethe, Schinkel, Brydon, or Guy de Montparnasse. We made an experiment to map those places that they basically try to describe in their paintings or in their literary production. And this is basically an elevation of Palermo compared to this plan. You can see basically that a lot of the places are distributed along a very extended geography. So it's basically the same representation that those cartography or paintings would actually show you. If you compare this to the touristic city of today, this is what you get. So there has been basically a contraction, a substantial contraction of the experience and of the, let's say, of the storytelling of this landscape through, let's say, in the past 50 years due to the acceleration of mass tourism and, of course, in combination with the neoliberal economy. So these are maps that we know very, very well. And they, of course, tell the story of a contraction not only in terms of geographic dimension, but also in terms of experiential dimension and value that are proper of the city. As you know, also Palermo was inscribed, at least, let's say, the Arab Norman Parkour was inscribed in the UNESCO World Heritage Site, which corresponded to an immediate increase of tourism. So in a way, the same institution that is supposed to defend and protect the heritage of the city is actually promoting its accelerated development. So these two conditions are very, in a way, contrasting each other, as you will know from the case of Syracuse. Which results basically into a series of hotspots of great attention to economic development and a series of, let's say, further developed areas which are instead neglected by the touristic development. And of course it results in this, in a way, so a simplification of the urban experience that is manifests through, let's say, what we normally define as gentrification, what we normally define as the appropriation of, for example, specific brands, of the signs, culture, languages, evidences of the city into something that can be consumed and communicated. This is an ad by Dolce & Gabbana. They are becoming my specific negative obsession in the past in the past months, also because they recently, you know, organized a very strange cup talk in Palermo. But the hashtag, you can see it says real people, and of course it doesn't, it's not enough to turn the culture of origin into attendance or into a fashion to actually talk about real people. So these are the kind of dangers that were explained, of course, at the beginning of the introduction by Mafalda Rangel of this workshop. And also this, of course, conditions, so the appropriation by UNESCO of specific conditions of the city, it's not taking in consideration what the city stands for, at least what the city basically has been turning to in the past 30, 40 years. What is the mundialized Palermo? So which kind of world is present in Palermo as opposed to the one that actually makes its history? This map shows in a way the relationship, the, let's say, trans-territorial relationship of Palermo. So in a way it shows in which part of the world Palermo exists and in which parts of the world exists in Palermo. And this is something that is producing an impact. Matilde Cassani after me will probably explain this much better, but it's basically producing an impact in terms of constellation of the population that lives in Palermo, but also rewriting of the very traditions of the city, or the very cultural traditions of the city, to the point that maybe we could be ready to redefine, in a way, the geography of Palermo, starting from new values, which do not correspond necessarily to the ones which are actually identified by the UNESCO or by the so-called Global Force of Preservation and Heritage, Global Task Force of Preservation and Heritage. Now, a few years ago, at the 12th Architectural Venice Biennial, we declared our interest for these topics through an exhibition. At the time, it was called Chronochaos. And Chronochaos had the ambition to basically unveil part of the contradiction and controversies of the preservation regime, starting from the institutional bodies like UNESCO, or starting basically from our own emotional bond to preservation, or to history in general. Chronochaos was investigating first the exponential growth in size of what we preserve, so what we call as history. In only 150 years, we went from preserving officially historical monuments to the landing of the moon in 1969. So an exponential growth of size, but also an exponential growth in numbers. This graph shows basically what's or it's already preserved, the red, and what is waiting to be inscribed in the UNESCO World Heritage program. The red is mostly, or in the majority of the red, is mostly focusing in Europe, while the white is equally distributed across the five continents. So the what we call as the, let's say, the heritage is becoming almost a right for equal development in a way between continents. And maybe in a way that is a little bit extreme, we try to give a graphic dimension to the areas in the world which are in fact preserved, as opposed to the areas which are not preserved, accounting to a total of 12%. So the world is somehow divided into areas of accelerated development and areas of total status, we call them in the exhibition. And this is actually a key, maybe, map for your discussions and my discussions for this talk. It shows basically the increase of tourism in countries that join the World Heritage Convention. You see, a lot of the countries are actually in developing continents, and the increase of tourism is really substantial. Preservation is a business. The UNESCO is, in fact, a form of business. And today, in fact, an article published on Repubblica was basically trying to measure the amount of money moved around the Matera, UNESCO Capital of Culture of 2019, approximately 1 billion euros, which means basically that the way we approach preservation is somehow steered around by forces which are not necessarily about the authenticity of history or the authenticity of the monuments or cities that we are considering. There are basically forces which are about political correctness and let's say equal economic development spread by UNESCO across multiple points on the face of the planet. So that there are, in fact, contradictions in this kind of story. Sagrada Familia in Barcelona is has been inscribed, or let's say, listed in the World Heritage program in 1984. As you know, normally the way we approach our past is supposed to basically consider the past with an objective kind of with objective kind of values. Sagrada Familia is, in fact, a sort of caricature of Gaudi's work. It's known, but it's of course a major touristic attraction, and therefore it becomes basically part of the UNESCO Heritage Foundation. Our fever for preservation doesn't stop to the tangible. In 2003, the World Heritage Convention has launched a program to preserve, along with, let's say, any kind of built environment typologies, also what it's normally defined as intangible heritage, so from tradition to storytelling to procession to acupuncture, etc. Subtracting these kind of, let's say, practices to the regular flow of history. So making, in a way, a sort of diffuse, intangible museum of cultural practices. And this is, for example, acupuncture in China, which was recently subscribed or listed as part of the World Heritage Foundation. I was mentioning before about the controversial idea that we have about our past, in a way. And maybe Sagrada Familia or other cases show that we have a kind of a attitude towards the past or towards history that is maybe more about nostalgia than memory, or maybe more about, let's say, subjective values than objective values. In the words of the past, Svetlana Boym, a scholar from Harvard who passed away a couple of years ago, nostalgia goes beyond individual psychology. At first glance, nostalgia is a longing for a place, but actually it is a yearning for a different time, the time of our childhood, the slower rhythms of our dreams. In a broader sense, nostalgia is a rebellion against the modern idea of time, the time of history in progress, the nostalgic desires to obliterate history and turn it into a private or collective mythology, to revisit time like space, refusing to surrender to the irreversibility of time that plagues the human condition. In combination to mass tourism and the liberal economy, nostalgic attitude to the past creates monsters, in a way. And those are the monsters that basically populate every single touristic city or every single touristic offer that we can find walking around our own cities in Europe or specifically in Sicily. But of course then our generation, in a way, or our, let's say, the politically correctness of, let's say, the attitude of preservation has eliminated from, or let's say, taken away from the domain of history, specific pasts that are charged, ideologically charged, and that of course are uncomfortable to many. This is Albert Speer presenting his project for Haus der Kunst in Munich to Adolf Hitler. Haus der Kunst was supposed to be, in fact, a propaganda-making machine. In a way, a museum that was supposed to stage the art of the Nazi regime in order to promote the values of the Nazi regime. So, art of this kind. Yeah? So, you have to think that basically, in parallel, in the same years, Dadaism was happening, many avant-garde movements were happening, which Nazi basically tried to silence, in a way. After World War II, so on the wake of the total refusal or total neglect of the Nazi ideology, Haus der Kunst was not demolished, but neutralized. So it was painted white, white curtains were basically folded around whatever was left of the Nazi interior project, and every single element that was, let's say, put aside or was basically hidden in the basements. So from, let's say, the furniture used by the Nazi regime to the signage of the restaurant to through even the doorknobs. This, in fact, is the doorknob that we had in the exhibition in Venice, which still has the signs of the white paint of this process of neutralization of history carried on immediately after World War II. Other buildings instead had a completely more dramatic fate. Maybe you know about this discussion, but for us it was a very relevant discussion to show this selective attitude towards history. This is an image of an already abandoned Palace de République in Berlin. Palace de République was basically the building hosting the parliament of the DDR, so East Germany. And it was actually built after World War II on top of the Schloss Berlin, so this historical building that you see on the top. The demolition of this building was basically initiated by a competition which was won by an Italian architect, by the way, which proposed to rebuild a very similar project to the original Schloss, so a totally nostalgic kind of attitude and also a refusal of history, obviously. And in a way, on the wake of this proposal, citizens of Berlin actually initiated a very, strong protest. In the meantime, while the debate was actually carried on, the interior of the building was used as a sort of informal, bottom-up cultural center, which was very successful for many years, but eventually the battle was lost and the Schloss was built. So, and for us this is, of course, was a very interesting case, because not only proved how selective preservation is, how specific, how intolerant we are to specific parts of our past, but also about the pervasiveness of our nostalgic attitude to the past. A nostalgic attitude that is present in architecture, it's present in design, and I mean, it's difficult to define basically when this picture was taken, but it was taken 2 years ago, and for me it's in a way quite of a big issue, because it's a refusal of time in a way. In fashion, again, Dolce & Gabbana is my negative obsession at the moment, but this is a picture from the last show that I had in Palermo, where, you know, like, basically the decor of the city becomes fashion in a translation which smells very much like simplification. And even in music, this is still showing from an early work that we did 2 years ago, showing basically what Simon Reynolds, a music critic, calls retromania, so the tendency of the first two decades of in the music industry, specifically in the electronic music industry, to actually re-edit genre from the past in a sort of explosive and constant re-editing and refusal of basically taking the chance to actually identify its own identity in the present. And eventually, there are also signs in visual arts of nostalgic attitude or re-editing of pre-existing works. So this is, I'm sure you know it, it's a very famous performance work by Marina Abramovic. First stage in 1977 by Marina Abramovic and Goulet, then reenacted in 2007 in Second Life, and then eventually reenacted by Marina Abramovic herself in 2010 for a famous show at MoMA. Obviously, I'm not trying to define a specific reality, or this is obviously not the picture of everything that is out there. I'm just trying to show you there are some cases of fascination with the past, even in these cases when performance was actually meant to be unique and actually an instant representation of a specific moment. We were, in a way, both victims and executioners of this tendency when a few years ago we were asked by Fondazione Prada to restage a legendary exhibition curated by Aaron Zeman in 1969 at the Kunsthalle in Bern. The exhibition was called, here is Aaron Zeman, very intimidating as usual, and the exhibition was called When Attitude Becomes Form, and our exhibition was called When Attitude Becomes Form, Bern 1969, Venice 2013. the original exhibition was basically pulling together a young generation of artists who then became extremely famous, from Sol Hewitt to Daniel Buren to Mario Merz. Anyway, people who were at the time in their early 20s to stage and put together basically works specifically developed for the Kunsthalle Band, so site-specific, very conceptual or abstract. What is very crucial by these images is that the Kunsthalle became a laboratory where the presence of each work and the presence of each artist was negotiated among themselves, and of course thanks to the facilitating role of the curator. So this, you see some of the works here. I'm not going to go into details, but so we were asked an impossible task. So to restage an exhibition that was meant to exist only as a site-specific work, which actually had already two other editions in Amsterdam and London, each one different from the previous one. So how do you museify in a way an exhibition that was never meant to actually exist through time? We decided to take the exercise extremely literally, or maybe seriously, or maybe both. The point for us was that if it was about a reconstruction, we decided to reconstruct literally the Kunsthalle Band inside Caponnette della Regina, which is basically the home of Fondazione Prada in Venice, one-to-one, and this is not a reconstruction of the Kunsthalle Band of today, it's a reconstruction of the Kunsthalle Band of 1969. In order to do that, we have to basically extract images from the Getty Institute from the original exhibition. This you see young Sol Hewitt preparing his work on the walls of the Kunsthalle Band. Use the pictures as drawings, so basically as guidelines to restage nostalgically this exhibition. So use the pictures basically as drawings. And we began to somehow put it together. I don't know whether I'm actually convinced of this operation. I think it was actually an extremely critical project where the only added value was actually the overlapping between the new architecture and the old one, and in the combination of the two there was something new that we were saying, but otherwise I found this operation extremely critical. Specifically for the reason of trying to restage something that was never meant to be restaged. So to turn into a product or into something that you could eventually replicate through times and in different locations. We went, as I told you, very literally. So Daniel Buren, who was not invited to the exhibition, decided to protest in Bern by putting his posters outside the Kunsthalle, and so we put the posters of Daniel Buren outside Cornell in Venice. This is a picture of the installation. More than anything, it was almost like a cinematographic, stage where neither the original house, neither the reconstruction of the Kunsthalle Band was actually, referring to a specific time. It was a sort of a limbo time, suspended. Having said that, I think this project, in a way like the Marina Abramovic re-editing that I showed you before, was actually convincingly deploying this very nostalgic attitude that part of the artwork is actually still developing at the moment. Finally, this is maybe an anecdote, but quite symptomatic of the criticality of this project, the phone that you see in the black and white pictures. It was a phone. There was basically an artwork by Walter de Maria. Walter de Maria was supposed to call in to the exhibition during the opening day. He didn't in the original one, but he did in the restaging of 2013. Of course, Miuccia Prada answered the phone, the only one allowed to answer the phone. So here you see already the friction between such an operation and the original ambition of the project. Walter de Maria died 2 weeks later. I don't know whether, it's something. So, of course, mini stage exhibition, we did it very literally. The reconstruction of the works was very precise, but at the same time, of course, we could not restage the condition that allowed when attitude becomes form to happen. Now, we move to a few 200 meters away to the Canal Grande, to the Fondo con I tedeschi. Am I doing okay?
I think it's fine. No?
Anyway, okay.
Yeah, I think it's fine.
Okay, and as I told you at the beginning, this is something that me and Francesco struggled through many, many years, dramatically. But maybe it's good to show the drama behind this project also. The Fondo Kredeski is a building originally from the 13th century, but then rebuilt at the beginning of the 16th century, and used originally as a trading post for German merchants, so it was a commercial building since the beginning. In the 1930s, this is a picture of how we found the Fondo in 2009. In the 1930s, it was turned into the central post office of Venice, but because, of course, of the declining population of Venice, the role of the central post office diminished in tandem with the decline of the population. So that, for example, after the first level, what we found was this, so abandoned office, mediocre office spaces. What is also very interesting about this project is that we were asked to develop, in a way, both the preservation project, but before that, to propose to the client a potential scenario, programmatic scenario of development of this project. So, and when we thought about that, this is a graph that was inevitable to refer to. It's a graph of the decline of population in Venice as opposed to the increase of touristic presences. Which of course was approved for us of the progressive devitalization of the city, devitalization of urban values and qualities of the city. What we propose as in response to the ambition of the client to actually develop the Fondo into a 4-star hotel, we propose to actually develop it into a department store. Looking back at the models of the 19th century department stores, which have been consolidated urban functions for many cities around Europe, so from London to Berlin to Milan, etc. So not just touristic parasite in a way, but something that was in a way appealing to both tourists and citizens alike, able to offer a commercial offer, but also acting as a social aggregator. What is interesting about this project is that the Fondo is definitely not an original. And in a way, what we found out is that this is a condition that is very common in Venice. These are pictures of the 1930s transformations, facing an imminent collapse into the Canal Grande. At the time, fascist governance of the city decided to rebuild it in reinforced concrete, or rebuild the structure in reinforced concrete. I'm making things a little bit simple, but in a way, the Fondo is neither a monument from the 16th century, neither a modern architecture. It's somehow two buildings at once. It's a palimpsest of construction techniques that unfolds through 5 centuries of history. So, in a way, we spend the first years kind of mapping the degree of artificiality of this so-called monument, of course protected like an historical authentic monument. So if you take out from the ground floor whatever is left of original stones and materials, this is what you get. Rather little, I would say. So, this is some pictures from our forensic kind of investigations where, step by step, in a way, the original structure from the 1930s was actually unveiled. And again, this notion of two buildings into one. And that's how this project, in a very far dramatic stretch, is also related to the first installation project that I show you. Preservation is always about dealing with this schizophrenic condition. You don't deal with one authenticity, you deal with many. When you deal with an historical building, very often you deal with one or two or three buildings at once. The huge polemic around this project was actually part of our first 3 years of work. This also gives you a degree of course, how sensitive these issues are in places like Italy or Europe in general. It seems basically that we were kind of touching and destroying an historical monument, but of course this monument was not really historical, it was actually the output of multiple transformations. I'm going to go through the project quite quickly. It's organized around two, let's call it semi-public spaces, where, let's say, activities which are different from commercial activities are supposed to happen. One is the inner courtyard, the other one is the pavilion that is being restored on top of the courtyard, a pavilion that was put there in 1898. The courtyard basically, at least in our intention, was supposed to be free or immune from commercial occupation because we wanted to use it for, let's say, programs open to the city in collaboration with the rest of the city's institutions. The two public spaces, in a way, are connected by, let's say, a series of new vertical distributions that are acting like, let's say, excavation through the mass of the fondaco. The most critical of this vertical distribution devices was the escalator. The escalator originally had a version that we thought was an interesting experiment of a modern invention. So we made an escalator that was able to move like basically a bridge and liberate the courtyard for events, but this proposal was considered obscene. Obscene was basically what the preservation architect wrote in their document. So they said, this is obscene. So we said, okay, what do we do? Then we push back the escalator into the main volume of the building. And this is another contradiction, for example, that happens very often when you deal with preservation. By doing this, we were allowed to demolish much more. So we had to preserve the image of the courtyard, but by preserving the image of the courtyard, the image, not the substance of the courtyard, in a way, we were able to open, let's say, a vertical space, which was in the end probably more exciting than the first proposal, but still affecting more, of course, the, let's say, compactness of the building. The rest of the project is basically minor adaptations to the existing layouts, for example, the branding areas or the commercial areas that occupy, that are occupying now, the infila rooms that were already present in the building. And I'm now going to run you through some pictures just to show you the results of it. Basically, we use the project to actually unveil part of the, let's say, history of transformation of the buildings, so from the 16th century up to the present intervention, the one that we did. And when I was saying that we basically accepted every, let's say, layer of authenticity, so every moment is authentic for us, we tried to preserve the majority of, for example, what was left of the 1930s intervention. In this case, this is a historical entrance. In the new entrances, we unveil the reinforced concrete structure that was implemented in the 1930s to show right away the brutality of this building, but also the technological brutality of this building and probably of Venice in general, which is a city that is much more modern of what we would tend to think. Again, this is the vertical space of the escalator. Every single vertical distribution is used to, as a sort of coring through the existing mass, so that all the layers of, let's say, transformation of the buildings are unveiled in specific moments. The escalator is unveiled, and there was actually a compromise that we obtained by pulling the escalator inside the main mass through a shield-like hole, which in a way was supposed to open a degree of permeability through the project in a building that otherwise would have been extremely compact, and of course this sequence of planes in a way was serving a sort of a framing in a way, frames now in a way the movement of people through the building. Here's another image of the shield-like opening. And then again, when you look at an image like this, whatever you consider historical is actually not as historical as you might think it is. So this image shows in one single picture a concrete beam from the 1930s, a floor from the 20th century, our intervention on the back, the part of the materials, part of the stone materials from the original part of the building, so from the original time of the building. So in a way, what looks like history is in fact a collage of different epochs. Back into the bowels of the building again, the vertical distribution works like excavations, and I like to think that in 10 square meters there are maybe 4 centuries of accidents happening, including the light traces of the 1980s. The project ends with the restoration of the pavilion, which is basically the end of the parkour of the public. a new ceiling floor was inserted to actually support a new floor, so that the pavilion would be made accessible. It's obviously a modern Mises-like insert. You reach this level through multiple vertical distribution, but especially the last movement of the escalator. You're releasing to a new corridor, you're releasing to the restoration, into the restored pavilion. It is basically a historical restore cap hovering over new elements. And from here, you're released into an expansive public view of the city. What was very important for us is that by pushing the program of a department store, we ensured the possibility of this building to be still publicly accessible. So not a public function per se, but a building that can be experienced, let's say, by people beyond, let's say, its commercial purposes. I don't have pictures that are very beautiful from the occupation, but fortunately there are Instagram pictures, so I can show you a little bit of what's happening now, what happened in the past months. The terrace is perfect for selfies, obviously, of many species. The pavilion is used actually for exhibitions, so not for commercial purposes. The galleries are used almost like a bazaar, so they have a very good occupation, and sometimes they're used also for activities, so they're really related to the experiential, let's say, visit of the building. We did not take care of the interiors. Unfortunately, there was a strong discrepancy between us and the interior designers, but in a way, the spaces that we delivered were merely occupied. And among our prescriptions, we invited the tenants to leave the windows open so that, differently from many other department stores, the Fondoc itself would become a sort of periscope into the rest of Venice, also to the generic part of Venice. And here the escalator has come to life. So you see it here, we can go quite quickly. Yeah. Back into the commercial areas, and the courtyard portion is used as a cafe or sometimes also for activities. Now, if you give me still 5 minutes, I'd like to show you a project that I think is one of the clearest projects that AMO developed in the past 10 years, and it has to do a lot with your topic, although on a completely different scale and ambition. Before the broke of the Arab Spring, we were asked to look at Libya, at the Libyan desert. And the reason why we were asked, basically the mandate was to find an area to develop a large touristic resort. And this project started with a long trip across the Libyan desert. And basically one of the conclusions of this long trip is that what looks empty is actually full of eroding traces and activities. There is a form of tourism in these areas which is completely unregulated, and it is affecting, almost invisibly but very dramatically, this landscape. You see here, for example, this is a... and all the traces that you see on these dunes are actually generated by these large trucks that are bringing tourists around to visit and experience the Libyan desert. The first phase of this work was about mapping all, let's say, the historical heritage of this place. So, in a way, to map the richness of pre-existing conditions from oases to, let's say, small settlements. And then, before starting the design, we sort of asked ourselves whether we were supposed to actually deliver a project for tourists or deliver a project for travelers. So, who is our target? And we decided for a second one. So we decided to, in a way, refuse the mandate and reinvent the mandate to a certain degree. So the second part of the work was about exploring all those small infrastructures, places, gas stations, bars, that allow the desert to be inhabited. So from small huts, gas stations, to informal markets where shade is provided by simple tents pulled across, let's say, a non-finished structure. So the point was here, in our clients apparently were not really happy, was basically, okay, maybe instead of offering you what you want, we can maybe offer nothing. Because offering nothing, which means of course offering just the extensiveness of the landscape we were confronted with stand out in basically in a world of, in the world of mass tourism where everybody promises the world and therefore promises nothing is a much stronger statement than anything else. So we were kind of triggering the discussion through visuals like this. So where on one side you have a typical Dubai resort offering quite an extensive list of functions, and on the other side you understand what we wanted to open, what we wanted to offer. Which meant, of course, a shift into our practice from architecture and master planning to technology and logistics. Meant a third mapping of a pre-existing infrastructure in the Sahara Desert in Libya, such as, for example, photovoltaic stations, which are already present, but we propose to maximize. I won't show you the project, we'll show you just the strategy of this project. These were, let's say, the existing Silk Road system across the desert, the ones which were supposed to be planned. What we offered was purely a zooming, where we identified those places that had to be preserved, we identified a grid of power station to allow people to cross the desert and to rest, if they had to rest. And we identified, for example, let's say, those few heritage spots of attention, but never forgetting the dimension of journey as the quintessential, let's say, ambition of, in a way, any touristic or travel experience along the, across the world. I'm done. Okay, obviously, this was finished when the Arab Spring broke out, and nothing, unfortunately, happened afterwards. This was one of the projects that we presented in Chronoc House after the opening was taken away because, of course, because of the Arab Spring, it was considered too, let's say, controversial to discuss touristic development in a moment of political turmoil. Thank you.
Win. Thank you. No, I really thought the presentation was great. I think I really much appreciate it. I think I can say this for everybody. The rigorous way you, through your work, you introduce us to the vision of the studio into the theme of authenticity. Not sure how much time we have for questions, but maybe one question I would like to... Yes, sorry.
Maybe I just like to ask you just a question in regards to what you guys are doing in Palermo, because of course since you're in Sicily, we're very much curious, because Nicholas is now acting as a curator, one of the curators for Manifesta that is coming up next year. And we thought it was very interesting they asked for an actor to be involved in this process. So we just want to know if you can briefly introduce us to the work that you mentioned in the beginning, but also maybe mentioning in which way do you think an architecture studio, the architecture practice, can make a difference in the reading of the city and preparing a curatorial project framework for Bayenia, which is all the time moving into the city. And so it's very much related to the public space and the
city. I think the main ambition to invite us was to switch around the curatorial model. So I'm now working as one of the curators together with other three people. But before this, we have developed through a period of 3 to 4 months a preparatory investigation of the city. And in a way, it seemed that the ambition of Manifesta was instead of what they did in the past, which was basically inviting some curators to write a concept, and then the concept would be applied in the city. The project is the city in our case. So we are kind of extracting all the topics that we are planning to develop through, of course, cultural and artistic production from the city itself. Then, of course, there is a topic, of course, there will be a curatorial program that is somehow dependent and independent from our studies. But the ambition was basically to look at Palermo, establish why it is relevant for Europe, the Mediterranean, but also for this notion of mondialization, so which is what we understand as a phase that has followed globalization. So Palermo represents some part of the world, of everything. In a way, part of the condition that we observe in the city and which we would like to extract for the curatorial project and for the artistic production are exactly those conditions that actually tell the story of Palermo, but of a whole region. Then there is a notion that maybe is a little bit more pragmatic. The city, apparently, we found out in this month, has specific applications, specific needs, also on an urbanistic level. So part of the study that we are doing is about locations and how, in a way, through Manifesta, like for example, Documenta has been doing in Kassel for a long time, in a way the artistic production can initiate small processes for transformation. So there is one level that is thematic and the other level that is more, in, let's call it infrastructure, but of course a biennium is never a, we're not a United Nations.
No.
There is a limit, but we can steer a few things around.
So you hope in any case that this will have a long-term impact on the city?
Yeah, we hope so.
That's
it. I mean, at least part of the projects, this is maybe what we did in the first phase was a way to mediate with the city. So the document of the study that we produced was a mediation more than anything else. So it's a way to get to know people, to get to know places, to get to know things which normally are not that evident when you jump into a place. What we would like to do is that every single project that we develop will be developed in partnership. So ideally, whenever we have an artist that we invite, where the conditions are there, it will be coupled with a local entrepreneur. So that in principle artists can be a geographer, can be a writer, it's not necessarily artists from the visual art domain. But in principle, it is in this collaboration that we see the long-term impact. So in a way, the invitation is to react to projects which are needed at the moment, on which people are already working. So I would hate this project to become just another, catwalk, yeah, in the way of art. It doesn't really mean anything.
And last question. You know, as designers, we often struggle when we engage in a research process to somehow translate the research we're doing into something which is more shareable with a larger public. And I'm thinking to be working on Italia, or for instance, even now that you presented the Atlas, you set a very specific medium of visualizing this research. I'm just interested in understanding how, at one point in the process, you sort of decided which is the best way of presenting a research process, because that's always immense. Or it's a very difficult process because you risk being very literal or to do not to end up in sort of the form of illustration sometimes. So translation is always a very difficult task.
Also depends. Sometimes we know from the start how the research is supposed to become at one point. In the case of no counts, we had to deliver a project.
Exactly. I was thinking that, you know, when you have such a commission, how do you decide to visualize that kind of process?
But no counts was basically a three-dimensional function, in a way. It was treated like a three-dimensional function. So very bi-dimensional. In the case of the Atlas, we wanted to have a document that is shareable. So the Atlas is now being translated with a role in the audience, is also part of the process. Is being translated, or it will be translated into an actual book, and maybe that book will become a series of books that Manifesta will do in every single city that we will interact.
So it becomes more like a program.
It's programmatic. We never research without having the way the output defined. Yeah. Sometimes the output can be extremely traditional, extremely classic, but it doesn't really matter.
Thank you.
Thank you.